Good morning, dear students. So in the last class, we have discussed about the data quality. Okay, so in that we have seen what are the different kinds of measures, that is errors, that is measurement error and the data collection errors we have seen. Okay, then we have seen what is a noise and then what is an artifact. Okay. So now coming to the next thing, that is about how we can measure the quality of the data. That is, what is the metric which we have got in order to measure the quality of the data. So just like how we are going to measure the that is quality of the students with the help of marks or the percentage. So in the same way, see how we can measure the quality of the data which we have collected or which we have measured in the measurement process. Okay. So in order to measure the quality of the data in the measurement process, okay, so we are going to use three metrics here. So one is precision, and second one is bias, and third one is accuracy. So these are the three different measures which are used to measure the quality of the data. Okay. So see here, then what is this precision, bias, and then accuracy? See how we can use these things in order to measure the quality of the data. So precision is nothing but see, it is the closeness of the repeated measurements to one another. See, let us assume that we are measuring one quantity here. Okay. So while measuring, okay, so I'll take total five measurements here. And in these measurements, see these five measurements, how much close to each other. Okay, so that closeness, see, that is called as a precision here. For example, see, using a scale, you are performing some measurement here. Okay, so you want to measure one quantity here. Okay, so approximately, see, for example, it is 5 centimeter or 10 centimeter. Okay, so you will be performing the measurement that is 5 times here. So first time you'll get the measurement as 5.01, and second time 5.2, like that. So you'll get the measurements here. So to how much extent they are close to each other. So that closeness of the measurements, it is called as precision. So precision is nothing but, say, it is the closeness of the repeated measurements to one another. See, while measuring the quantity, see how much close those measurements are to each other. So that closeness is called as a precision here. So second one is bias. Okay, so bias is nothing but, see, it is the systematic quantity that you are measuring. So what is the quantity, okay, so that you are measuring, so that is called as a bias here. Okay, so I will explain you with the help of one example here later. Okay, just try to understand this definition. See, bias is the systematic quantity that is being measured here. Okay, and precision is the closeness of the repeated measurements to one another. Then how we can exactly measure in terms of mathematics here? So see here, see, precision is normally measured using standard deviation of the set of values here. So if you find the standard deviation of the set of values, okay, so that standard deviation stands for the precision. Okay, and the bias will be calculated, see, by taking the difference between the mean of these values, okay, and the actual quantity which you are measuring. Okay. So I will give you example here, you'll understand it. See, precision is the standard deviation. Remember this one, precision will be calculated with the help of standard deviation. Okay, and bias is calculated by taking the difference between the mean of the set of values and the actual quantity which you are measuring. Okay, that is the bias here. Okay, so see here, let us consider one example. Let us consider that, see, I've got a standard laboratory weight here. Okay. So with this weight, say I want to measure the quantity here that is of that is having mass of 1 gram here. So the quantity being measured is, see, the that is size of that quantity is 1 gram here. Okay, so now, say, using this laboratory scale, say I'm doing the measurements and I will obtain total 5 that is measured values here. See, those measured values are 1.015. Actual quantity which I'm measuring is 1 gram. Okay, say while doing the measurement using a laboratory scale, say I'm getting these values 1.015, okay, and then 0.9901. Total 5 values, 5 times I have taken the measurements here. Okay, so approximately, see, these values are that is close to each other. See, the quantity of which I'm measuring is 1 gram. Okay, while measuring, while measurement process, say I'm getting the values as 1.015, okay, 0.9901. And then 1.0131, okay, 1.001, 0.986. See, all these values are closer to 1 gram. Okay, so now then, how we can measure the that is precision and bias. Then how we can calculate the precision and bias? See, I told that see precision is nothing but the standard deviation, and bias is nothing but it is the difference between the mean and the actual quantity which I am measuring. Okay. So let us first calculate the bias here. Okay. So what is the mean of these five values? So mean is nothing but I need to add all these five values and then divide by five. So if I add all these values and if I divide that by five, I'll get the mean. So mean value which you're going to get is 1.001. So when you add these values and divide that by five, and the actual quantity that I'm measuring is 1 gram. Okay. So now if I take the difference between the mean and the actual quantity that I'm measuring, so that is going to give me the bias. So bias is nothing but see, it is the difference between the mean of the set of values and the actual quantity which I'm measuring. Okay. So the mean I got is 1.001 for the set of five values. Okay. And the actual quantity is 1 gram. So difference between these two is 1.001 minus 1 is 0.001. Okay. So that is my bias for this measurement process. Okay. Then precision is the standard deviation. So standard deviation calculation, say I hope that say everyone knows how to calculate that. Say it is square root of, say subtracting each of these values from the mean and then taking the square and then divided by total number of values here. Okay, that is 5. Okay, so if I consider the subtraction of the set of values from the mean, that is 1.015 minus 1.001 square plus 0.9901 minus 1.001 square, like that. If I add those values and then divide that by 5, I'll get the standard deviation as 0.001. So that is my precision. Okay. So here the precision is the closeness of the repeated measurements to one another. See, here I'm measuring the quantity that is of 1 gram, and each time while measuring, say I'm getting the values here which are close to each other. Okay. And if I find the standard deviation, so I'll get the that is value of precision for that. Okay. And then bias is the systematic quantity which I'm measuring. So that will be calculated with the help of difference between the set of values and the actual value which I'm measuring. Okay. So for this, see the mean is 1.001. And if I subtract that by actual value, so that is 0.001. So that is my bias here for this example. Okay. So now coming to the third one, that is accuracy. Okay. See, accuracy is nothing but see, it is the closeness of the measurement to the true value of the quantity being measured. Okay. So how much extent the measured value is close to the true value. Okay. So that is called as, that closeness is called as accuracy. Okay. So normally accuracy, say it will be evaluated with the help of use of significant bits here. For example, see in case of chemistry also, so you might have measured the accuracy. So each time in the lab, so you will be measuring one quantity and you will be getting some value. Okay, so that you are going to compare with the actual value. So true value and the measured value, they must be equal. Then only you are going to say that your experiment is correct. Okay, so in the same way, for example, if you are calculating the percentage of marks here, okay. So you need to get the calculated percentage value that must be equal to the actual value. Okay. So if those two are equal, if they are close to each other, okay, then we are going to say that our result is accurate. So this accuracy is nothing but, see, it is the closeness of the measurement to the true value, okay, of the quantity that you're measuring here. Okay. So now coming to the next thing, that is about the outliers. Okay. So seeing the previous topic, I told about the noise. Noise is actually, it is the random component of the measurement error. Okay, so it is going to distort the data value, or it is going to add the some of the extra values to the actual data. So that is called as a noise. Okay. Now coming to the outlier, outliers sometimes, they also mean just like a noise, but these outliers are sometimes very important for our data analysis also. I'll give you an example later. See, first let's see what exactly an outlier is. In case of data objects, we'll be having some data objects whose characteristics or the features will be somewhat different compared to other data objects in the data set. Okay. So you have got a collection of data objects here. See, in these data objects, you'll be having some set of objects whose characteristics or the features are somewhat different compared to the other data objects. See, such data objects are called as outliers. Okay. Or in some of the data objects, there will be some values of the attributes. See, those values of the attributes will be somewhat different compared to other values of the attribute. Okay. So such data values are also called as outliers. So with respect to objects, in case of a data set, we'll be having some set of data objects here whose characteristics or the features will be somewhat different compared to other set of objects in the data set. So such data objects are called as outliers. Or see, in case of individual objects, data objects, say we'll be having some set of values here, see whose data values will be somewhat different or unusual compared to other values of that attribute. Okay, so such data values are also called as that is outliers here. Okay, see, then what are the alternative names for these outliers? See, while explaining the data mining task, I told that, see, anomaly detection is the method which is used to find the anomalies, okay, which are present in the data. Okay, so the alternate name for this outlier is that is anomalous object or the anomalous values. Okay, then see, are these data outliers are they same just like your noise or not? Okay, see, data of outliers, see, they are very important to us compared to noise. See, noise is not the thing which is required for our data analysis, so it is not at all required for performing your data mining task. But outliers are sometimes these are the objects of our interest. They are required for performing our data analysis task. For example, say in case of credit card fraud detection, okay, so their outliers will be important because we'll be finding the frauds there. Okay, so that is one of the application of outliers here. Okay, and also in case of that is network intrusion detection, see, there also the outliers are very important. Noise is not important for my data mining task, but outliers are important for performing my that is data mining task. See, one example is that is credit card fraud detection, where unusual that is data objects or the values are important for me for performing my that is credit card fraud detection or for finding out the intrusion in a network. Okay, so in these cases, see, unusual objects or the objects which are having that is different characteristics will be important. So outliers are our objects of interest, but noise is not the interested that is data values for performing my data mining task. Okay, so this is about the outliers. Now coming to the next one is that is about the missing values. Okay, so even in case of that is your database system also, so you might have seen that, say, some of the in some of the rows, see, values will be missing in that. Okay, so you'll be having that is a tuple. Okay, so in that tuple, see, some of the values will be missing. Okay, so here the objects will be having some of the missing attribute values. See, one or more attribute values will be missing. Okay, then what are the reasons for these missing values? Okay, so one reason is, see, information will not be collected for those attribute values. For example, see, in a that is a person's that is a database table, say some people they don't want to tell their age or weight. Okay, so if they don't provide their age information or weight, say at that time, see, there will be missing value in that attribute. So that is one of the reasons. So here in this case, see, we have not collected the data. Since the data is not collected, so there will be missing values present in that data. One of the example is, see, some of the people, they don't want to reveal their age or weight. And in some cases also, see, some people, they don't want to mention their phone number or email ID since it is confidential. Okay, so if they don't provide that data, then also there will be some of the missing values present on those attributes. So this is one reason for missing values. And second reason is, see, some of the attributes are not applicable to all the objects. See, there will be some of the objects for which, see, these some of the particular attributes will not be applicable. See, you might have seen in some of the web applications, okay, so where there will be some of the exceptional fields which are not at all required for filling. Star mark, you'll be having star mark for mandatory fields, and the fields which don't have the star mark, they will not be important. Okay, so whenever you got such an option, you'll be filling all the fields which are with the star mark, and you will be leaving the fields which don't have the star mark. Okay, and then if you leave those fields which don't have the star mark, and then you if you submit that form, then in those attribute values place there will be blank values, attribute values present. There won't be any value stored in the database. Okay, that is also one of the reason. So some of the attributes, okay, so they will not be applicable to all of the objects. Okay, so one example is see, you might have seen in some of the that is web applications where your name and then the other details like your age, okay, they will be asking, city they will be asking. Okay, those fields will be mandatory, and some other fields will be optional, like for example your credit card information. Okay, so that will be left as it will not be given as star mark there. Okay, and then there will be some other fields also. Okay, so the fields we don't have the star mark, okay, so those will be left by the user. So at that time if we submit that such form, then those attributes will be having missing values. Okay, that is second reason. Okay, so missing values, say they are going to occur because the information will not be collected sometimes, or some of the attributes will not be applicable to all the data objects. So because of these reasons, missing values are going to happen in the data. Okay, so now see, whenever we are performing our data analysis task, see, we need to take these missing values into account for processing. Okay, see, sometimes even we need to fill those missing values. See, in your DBMS, say what you are going to do is, suppose if there is any missing value, so that you are going to fill with one common value, that is null. So that is one kind of that is thing you are going to do in your DBMS. Okay, then here what we are going to do in order to perform our data mining task efficiently whenever there is missing value present. Okay, so we have got some of the strategies here or techniques for dealing with the missing values. So first one is eliminate the data objects or the attributes. See, suppose if there is any missing value which is present in the data object or the attribute values, then first thing with the help of which we can deal with such data is, we can eliminate that data object which is having missing value, or we can eliminate the attributes which are having the missing value. Okay, so this is one of the simplest and easiest strategy where we will be eliminating the objects which are having missing values. Okay, but see, sometimes, see, even though there is missing values in the data objects, then that information may be required for performing by a data mining task. Okay, so it is not one of the good technique to eliminate the data objects which are having missing values. See, sometimes that partially specified data objects, see, they are going to contain some of the information here, so which will be required for performing my analysis task. Okay, so this is not one of the efficient techniques. Okay, and even see, we can eliminate the attributes which are having the missing values also. Okay, so if there are some of the attributes which are having missing values, then also we can remove that attributes from the that is data objects. Okay, but again, see, we may require see such kind of data which is having missing values in the future for performing my data mining task. So again, it is also not an efficient technique or the strategy for dealing with the missing values. So first technique is, that is eliminating the data objects or the attributes. So here we will be eliminating or removing the data objects which are having missing values, or we will be removing the attributes which are having missing values. Okay, so again, these this method is not an efficient method, because if you leave or omit such attributes or the data objects here, then such data may be required for my data mining task in the future. So it is not an efficient method. Okay, so now let's see the second one, that is estimating the missing values. Okay, so this is somewhat a good technique, and also it is a reliable technique where we can calculate the missing values using the other values of the attributes of the data objects in the data. Okay, see, for example, say if you got a time series data, okay, so where we have got the series of measurements. Okay, but in that, see, we have got some of the missing values. Okay, then how we can that is estimate or calculate that? See, time series is nothing but, see, it is a collection of measurements done over time. For example, temperature measurement. Okay, so in that temperature measurement, in that time series data, if you have got some of the missing values, See, what you can do is you can use the other attribute values in order to find the missing value. That is one of the method, see, which we can use to estimate the missing values. That is, we can use the values of the other attributes in order to find the missing values here. Okay. And see, one more thing is, see, even we can consider the attribute values which are closest to the that is missing value. Okay, so even that can be used to estimate the missing value. See, closest means, for example, you have got one of the attribute, see, where you got the age. Okay, so age of an person, okay, that is an attribute here. See, for one person, we have got the age, okay, that is approximately as 30, okay, and for another person, we don't have the age, okay. So if you look at the other values which are closest to that, if it is in the range of 30 only, okay, so in that missing place, I can fill the age as 30. Okay, that is, I'm estimating the value of an attribute based on the closest values which are nearer to that missing value. Okay, so if that value is missing, age is missing, then estimate that using the closest values. If all the ages, if they are nearer to, that is 30, okay, 30 and then 31, 32, like that, then I can estimate the value as 30, and then that value can be filled in the missed value place. Okay, that is one of the technique which we can use. And in some, that is attributes which are having continuous values. Okay, so in case of continuous values, that is integer values, even we can consider the average attribute values. Okay, so for example, see, if you have got total 5 rows here in the database, and in that one value is missing, but we have got the values in the other 4 rows. Okay, so again, if you consider the age only, so age is present for 4 people here, and but in one row, that value is missing. So you can calculate that value using the average of other 4 rows. See, again, if I consider the age as 30, 31, 32, and then 31. So then if I calculate the average, 30 plus 31 plus 32 plus 31, so divided by 4, I will get the average as somewhat 31.5. So that 31.5 can be filled in the, that is missing place. Okay, that is, I can calculate the, or I can estimate the missing value using the average of the attribute values here. That is for the continuous or the integer attributes. Okay, suppose if the attribute is categorical. So categorical means string type of attribute. So if you have got, then you can take the most commonly occurring values to fill the missing value. So for example, see, categorical attribute, so example, see, we can consider some of the attributes where employee ID is present. Okay, so employee ID, suppose if it is not present, okay, so we can fill that with the help of most commonly occurring value there. Okay, that we can consider for filling the missing values. Okay, so that is one kind of a string attribute here. So in case of categorical attributes, see, most commonly occurring attribute value we can consider. Okay, or else suppose if you got the department name, okay, which is missing in employee that is table, then you can fill that missing value by considering the most commonly occurring department there. Okay, so that is for the categorical attributes. That is how we can estimate the missing values. See here, suppose if the attribute values are missing, then we can calculate that by considering the attribute values of the other attributes. Okay, so for example, in case of time series, see, if you have got a series of measurements but some missing values are present, then we can estimate the missing value by considering the remaining values which are present in the time series data. Okay, so another example is, suppose if you have got a missing values, then those missing values can be filled by considering the attribute values which are closer to the missing value. So we can consider some of the closer values which are close to this value, and that can be filled there. Okay. So for continuous attributes or integer attributes, even we can consider the average of the attribute values for filling the that is missing value. Or suppose if it is categorical, that is string type of data, then most commonly occurring attribute value can be used to fill in the missed place. Okay. So this is the second strategy or the technique where we can deal with the missing values. And coming to the third one, that is ignoring the missing value. Okay, so while performing the analysis, even I can ignore the attributes or the data objects which are having missing values. Okay, So see, suppose if you have got one or more of the objects, okay, which have got the missing values for some of the attributes, okay, then here we can perform the analysis by considering only the attributes which have got some of the values which do not have the missing attribute values. So if you are considering a pair of attributes here, okay, or pair of objects where some of the objects have got the missing values, then you can perform the data analysis, okay, by considering only those objects which do not have the, that is, missing values. Okay, so that is, we are ignoring the missing values here and we are considering only the attributes or the data objects which do not have the missing values. So this is the third strategy. So here we have got total three strategies. That is, first one is eliminating the data objects or the attributes, that is completely removing the data objects or the attributes. Second one is estimating the values, missing values, so that is using the values of the other attributes. That is second thing. And the third thing is ignoring the missing values while performing the data analysis. That is, we can leave the attributes of the data objects which have got the missing values, and we can consider only the data objects which do not have the missing values. This is the third strategy. Okay, so this is about the missing value. Now coming to the next thing in the, that is, data qualities, inconsistent values. Okay, so inconsistent values means that inappropriate values. Okay, so there will be some of the data objects which are inappropriate or which are inconsistent with respect to other data. Okay, so for example, say if you have got the address field, okay, so where in the address field you'll be filling the that is zip code of the city, okay, and then you'll be sitting filling the city name. Okay, so in that, say you'll be filling the zip code, okay, that is zip code of a city wrongly. Okay, so for example, Davangere zip code is 577004. Okay, so instead of filling 577004, okay, so you'll enter it as 577009. Okay, so this zip code is not present in that that is city code list. Okay, so this kind of problem, so it will be happening, so because of two reasons. Okay, so one reason is, see, while entering the information here, okay, so for the address field, okay, so you have wrongly or inappropriately entered the digits here. Okay, that is, instead of writing 577004, you have transposed that last digit to 577009. So this is one of the reason. Okay, so second reason for inconsistency may be, see, while reading that form, okay, see, that scanning device, see, it has incorrectly read that data. Okay, so instead of reading 577004, it has read the data as 577009. So that is also one of the reason for this inappropriate data. Okay, so in some of the cases, say it will be very easy to find out such kinds of inconsistencies. For example, see, if you consider the height of a person, okay, so it, with respect to zip code, it will be quite difficult to find out, so whether it is an appropriate zip code or not. Okay, so because see, sometimes, see, if you want to find that inconsistency, then again you need to take the help of a dictionary where you got the information about all the zip codes of the cities. Okay, so it will be sometimes difficult in that zip code case, but some of the inconsistencies it will be very easy to find out. For example, see, if you consider the height of a person, see, height of a person must always be a positive number, it cannot be a negative number. So such kind of inappropriate data you can easily find. Okay, so in case of zip code, okay, so what you need to do is you need to take the help of external source of information. So external source of information is that is directory or your dictionary. So you need to take the help of that in order to find the inconsistency. Okay, so even in the insurance, that is company's case also. Okay, so whenever there is the reimbursement of the insurance, okay, whenever the person tries to claim the insurance, see, then they are going to check the name and address of that person by checking that information in the database of customers. Or if it is matched, then only they are going to give the claim to that person. Okay, so in the zip code case also, you need to take the help of a dictionary in order to check the inconsistency. Okay, see, once you check the inconsistency, or detect the inconsistency, even you can correct that easily. See, in this case, see, if you got the zip code wrongly, okay, that is 577009, you can change it to 577004. Okay, so that is, once I detect that inconsistency, even I can correct that with the help of that is some of the techniques here. Okay, so even if you got some of the wrongly entered product code, okay, so then also, so with the help of that is product checking that is device here, so you can check the inconsistent data, and you can correct that data. Okay, so that is one, that is also one of the method which is available here for that is detecting and correcting the inconsistent data. Okay, so this is about the inconsistent that is data values. Okay, so you do one thing. Okay, so you log out and log in again just for 10 minutes.